Hey, Dave, we just finished one of the most amazing seasons in the history of the Orioles. Where are we going to go now?
We're going to Superfresh. Come on.
This is for Cal.
Hey, Jeff. This is for Mickey.
All right. Superfresh has everything we need.
Hey, they even have the 89.
I got the butter.
I hope I'm in it.
Oh, Middle River will never be the same.
Dear Dad, what an incredible season. What an incredible year. It was like that movie, Field of Dreams. An unbelievable tale. I can hear John Miller now, narrating the highlights tape.
It all started in Sarasota, Florida, in mid-February.
It all started in Sarasota, Florida, in mid-February, when a bunch of hearty young ball players, many of them strangers, began an unforgettable season. They were young, innocent, eager, aggressive, and talented. As we would find out later, very talented. Curveball, strike three, called! The ball game is over! But could this young, untested team compete respectably against 13 American League rivals, all of whom had better records than the Orioles the year before? Could this club restore the pride and dignity that defined the Orioles for more than a generation? And could a team which had lost 107 games the previous year even dream that this was the beginning of one of the most exciting seasons in the history of the Orioles?
Why not?
I'd like to welcome all of you, the newcomers to spring training. My main concern is that we're in shape and we're sound fundamentally. It's not that big a difference in talent from one major league ball club to the other. But the real big difference is conditioning, execution of fundamentals.
That sign represents a tradition and not just a name. And we are dedicated to restoring this team to where it once was.
With those words, the leaders of the Orioles began the 1989 season. Outside, a new training complex accommodated the most efficient workouts in club history. Conditioning and fundamentals. Fundamentals and conditioning, practiced under the sun, day after day. Finally, after 6 weeks, the Birds were ready to play for real. Monday, April 3rd. A glorious day for baseball, as Chuck Thompson might have said. More than 52,000 fans embraced their young Orioles. It was the first test. It was opening day. The opponents were the defending division champion Boston Red Sox, led by Cy Young Award winner Roger Clemens. Baseball fever gripped the air.
I just knew I had to catch the ball.
In the third inning, Boston's Nick Osaski connected.
Yeah,
I didn't even think about the wall. I didn't think about anything else but catching the ball.
Right fielder Steve Finley was playing his first big league game.
Larry swung on, driven toward right center. Finley ranging right into the gap. Out of the warning track, he reaches up and he makes the catch. And then slams into the wall and then hangs on to it.
Next thing I knew, I was jumping up and down.
Hello, Steve Finley, and welcome to Baltimore.
Brady came over, gave me a high five, and I tried to lift my arm up, and it wouldn't go. I knew I was going to have to come out after that inning.
The injury disabled Finley for 3 weeks, but the catch set the tone for a season of dazzling defense. By the sixth inning, Boston led 3-1. And with two men on, the batter was Cal Ripken, the pillar around which general manager Roland Heeman had built this youthful ball club. Ripken, standing and waiting at the plate. Clemens into his stretch. The runners lead. The 2-2 pitch. Swing and a drive. Deep into left field. Back is Greenwell. Back he goes. Gone! A three-run homer for Cal Ripken. Memorial Stadium erupts. 4-3. The Orioles are on top. These Orioles of 89 had come to play. An eighth-inning Boston run tied it at 4, where it remained into the 11th inning. Mickey Tettleton walks. Tettleton takes ball 4. And Randy Milligan advances. To the runner going, the ball is lined at the right field base, head along the line. And Craig Worthington stepped to the plate. 1-0 the count. Smithson to the plate. There's a pop fly. Shallow left center field. Burks on the run. He dives. He can't get it. The ball game is over. Here comes Tettleton. He scores! 5-4, the Orioles. Worthington is the hero, and they're going crazy. 0-21? Not this year, thank you.
Dear Margot, we started the season in a very exciting manner. Imagine having to face Roger Clemens on opening day in the Boston Red Sox. The President of the United States was at Memorial Stadium, and he threw out the first ball. I tell you, it's a day I'll never forget. The next game, we beat Mike Boddicker, and then when we went on to Minnesota, we won a game against Frank Viola. That showed me that this ball club can compete against the best pitchers in the league, so I have a feeling this club might surprise some people. The guys are playing hard. They're playing gutsy baseball. It's great to see that kind of fresh attitude.
Wow, everybody's hustling and getting dirty, which reminds me of a trip I had in Boston around the bases. It was pretty interesting.
The stretch. Boggs, Ray Shallow at third, looking for the bunt. There goes Gonzalez. The ball is swung on and missed. Cerrone throws to second. The tag. Safe! He made it. There goes Gonzalez. The ball is taken. Throw down to third is wide, and he is safe! And it wasn't as easy as it sounded. Rene Gonzalez has turned a leadoff walk into a triple with two stolen bases. He's at third. The pitch. Swing and a ground ball to second that will score the run, or will it? Here comes a throw home by Barrett, and he misses the tag. He's safe! He did it again!
Our poor equipment manager, Jimmy Tyler. He's got a tough job this year.
This gritty style kept the Birds in the race in those first weeks of April. In the 22nd, they had an opportunity to take the division lead.
1-1 game, bottom of inning number 7 here.
The International League, and a dunker in the left for a base hit. Here comes Anderson. The throw by Gladden is not in time. The throw back to first, but Finley is safe.
Two gone in the seventh, a run in, bases loaded. There's a stretch in the 0-1 delivery. Tettleton swings and he grounds the ball. Base hit to right field. Here's Finley coming in to score. Cal is around third, being waved in. Here comes the throw. It's off. Cal has scored. Tettleton, a two-run single. The Orioles ahead, 4-1.
Two down. And now the pinch hitter, Albert D. Newman. And we'll see if Greg Olson is able to make Newman worry. The pitch lined into center. Brady to his left. He has got it, and the ball game is over. The Orioles have won it. The next day featured one of the very best pitching performances of the season. A cool, brisk day. Should have his strength, but he has not worked this deep into a game. Here's the 2-1 delivery. A one-hopper back to him. Malachi, the second one. Cal back to first. Two, a double play. Two down and nobody out in the ninth inning. That is the fourth double play
which Milwaukee has induced the Twins to hit. The Twins have had three hits. They have drawn two walks. They have put five men on base. Four have been wiped out in double plays, and the fifth on a steal was thrown out. Here is Newman, two down the pitch. Strike called, 0-1. Milwaukee is facing his 27th hitter of the day. That is the absolute minimum. The one strike delivery. Curveball grounded first base side. Milligan, he's got it. The ball game is over. And Bob Milwaukee is back. The Orioles remain in sole possession of first place. And Memorial Stadium still standing. Everybody still applauding the new Orioles.
The first place Orioles then headed to the West Coast that evening. In Oakland, they encountered a club that was not only leading the West, but was riding a seven-game winning streak. Three outs separated the Orioles from a dramatic victory, but that would be no easy task.
At first, I was kind of surprised they let me go into the ninth, just because of who was coming up, and it was a 2-1 game.
Dave Parker, Dave Henderson, and Mark McGuire, a menacing trio, would face the rookie right-hander from Omaha.
I was trying to get out of the inning alive, basically.
The stretch. And the 2-2 pitch. Curveball, he struck him out swinging. And there's one.
I got the first guy out, and I just kind of steamrolled a little bit. My adrenaline got flowing.
The Orioles out front, 2-1, last of the ninth. The pitch. Swing and a miss and another beautiful curveball. Boy, that one was a devastating curveball that came in there and just dropped a foot and a half. Two down, nobody on, one big out to go. It is Mark McGuire. McGuire standing menacingly at the plate. The pitch, a curveball, strike, one call. One strike to count the pitch, a fastball, strike, two called. Two down, nobody on. Two strikes to count to McGuire.
It's exactly the same way he pitched Henderson. Came in with a great breaking ball, then came in with a good fastball.
2-1 the Orioles. Two down, nobody on, last of the ninth. And Oakland has one strike of life left to them. The 2-2 pitch. A curveball got him looking. Strike three called. The Orioles have won it. McGuire looking at strike three. And Greg Olson pitches two perfect innings to save this one for Bautista. He strikes out four, and he strikes out the side in the ninth inning.
The performance took Greg's dad back to the days when he was his son's high school coach.
It was his senior year in high school, and we're playing for the state championship. We had won three in a row, and we're playing a rival school. It's a good ball club. And before the ball game, I always ask my pitchers, are you ready? You feel good? And this was kind of a touching moment because he came up before the ball game, and Kenny Rogers had a hit song out at that time called A Blaze of Glory. And he just put his arms around me and he says, Dad, let's go out in a blaze of glory. And that was, you know, my fourth state championship and his last ball game in high school. So that was a very touching moment for me. And in fact, that was a hit song and I still remember that very, very vividly.
Let's go out in a blaze of glory. All good things must end. Like two heroes in a story. Let's go.
After that win, the Orioles dropped three in a row for the first time, and the prospects for a fourth loomed in the Seattle Kingdome that last day of April. The Mariners led 3-2 in the eighth. A loss would drop the Birds out of first place.
And Pendleton hits it well to right field.
He drilled this ball. That's going to be
calls
up in there.
Look, it's gone! So he throws him a fastball, and the Orioles lead 4-3.
Jeff Ballard earned the win to become the first Oriole ever to go 5-0 in April. The month was over, and the Baltimore Orioles were tied for first place. What a different April! The club slumped briefly in early May, but manager Frank Robinson was not fazed.
Well, if we get good sound pitching, good sound, solid defense, play good fundamental baseball, and get some timely hitting, I think we can get back in this thing. I think we can catch fire.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much of love drives a man insane. You broke my will, but what a thrill. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. I let you love what I thought it was funny. You came along and woo, now honey. I've changed my mind, this love is fine. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. Kisses, baby.
feels good. Hold me, baby. Well, I want to love you like I love a shoe. You're fine, so kind. Got to tell this world that you're mine, 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 mine. I chew my nails and I twitch all my thumbs. I'm real nervous, but it sure is fun. Come on, baby. It drives me crazy. It's just great balls of fire. Love is good. You're fine. So kind. Got to tell this world that you're mine, 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 mine. Ain't you trying to kill that twin on my thumb? Real nervous, but it sure is fun. Come on, baby. Drive me crazy. This great, this is great. Balls of fire.
In late May, the Orioles compiled their first true winning streak. It lasted 5 games. A heartbreaker snapped it on a Sunday afternoon in Cleveland. Neither club had scored a run through 8.5 innings. Bob Malacky, most impressive again, pitched 8+ innings, but had nothing to show for his effort. In the bottom of the 9th, reliever Mark Williamson faced the imposing Joe Carter, a slugger who would end up the year with 35 home runs.
2 outs. Vermeen is at third. No score. We're in the bottom of the 9th inning as Carter steps in against Williamson. He drops a bunt. Williamson's got to make the play and can't do it. The Indians win it.
The competition did not let up even a little bit. The next day, future Hall of Famer Nolan Ryan, a National Leaguer the last 10 years, returned to Baltimore. Ryan into his windup and the 1-1 pitch. There's a high drive deep in the right center field. This one is really hit well and gone. 12 for Mickey Tettleton. He hit it against Ryan. 1-0 Orioles. Ryan into his windup. The pitch. Fastball. There's a long high drive. Tell it goodbye. Into right center. Gone. 2-0 Orioles.
Here's a 1-2 delivery. Cal swings and he sends a drive hit to deep left center. This one way back. Way back. Way back. Bye-bye. Cal Ripken.
Our heroes, ready for Ryan, launched the club's longest winning streak of the year.
This club is gelling. We've been in first place since May 24th, and now we're putting streaks together. We won 5 in a row, lost a tough one to Cleveland, and then won 8 more in a row.
That streak climaxed on June 5th in New York. It was the Birds' most lopsided win of the year.
Well, the bases are loaded for Jim Traber. He got a fat pitch and drills it to deep right center field. And a collision, the ball is dropped as Barfield and Brookins ran together. And the Orioles will get 3 runs.
The Orioles erupted for 4 more in the 3rd, then loaded the bases for Steve Finley.
Hit high and deep to right field. Brookins racing back, and it is gone! A grand slam home run for Steve Finley blows this game wide open.
We've had a change in ownership. The new ownership is led by Eli Jacobs, but he has said the philosophy will not change. Larry Lucchino and Roland Heeman have set a clear strategy: pitching, defense, and youth, and it's working. Of course, some timely power is helping too. Mickey Tettleton has come out of nowhere. He's been busting his tail, pumping iron, and working with Tommy McCraw. Although the story is that his success is coming from his breakfast cereal.
Mickey Tettleton had already hit more home runs by the end of May, 16, than any American League catcher since Rudy York in 1938.
Well, in spring training, he was eating Fruit Loops. And I know that sounds really corny and you'll kill me if he knows. But I fed him Fruit Loops and he was eating them and having a really good spring. And then we came up here and he, at first he was eating them and then kind of slacked off and was gotten a slump. And then I said, why don't you go back to eating Fruit Loops? So I went and bought like 2 of the biggest boxes I could find. And now he's eating them again.
Fastball is hit deep to right center field. It's gone. kids. Eat your Fruit Loops. That's number 12 for Mickey Tettleton, a new career high.
His heroics gave new life to an old baseball tune originally written for another slugger named Mickey.
Mickey who?
You know who, the fellow with the celebrated swing. Oh, I love Mickey.
Mickey who?
You know who, the one who drives me batty every spring. If I don't make a hit with him, my heart will break in two. I wish that I could catch him and pitch a little woo. I love Mickey.
Mickey who?
Mickey you.
Mickey me.
That's who.
In mid-June, the Yankees traveling show performed in Baltimore. It was a big series. New York was in second place. This was their chance to gain ground. The Orioles won the opener of the three-game series and then played a tight one. It moved to the ninth inning with the home team clinging to a 1-0 lead. A heavy fog began rolling in from left field. The bullpen tried to preserve yet another outstanding effort by Bob Milwaukee. It was an eerie sight. The Yanks put the tie and lead runs on, and up stepped Ken Phelps. The plot and the fog thickened. The outfield swung around toward the right in a very heavy fog. 1-0 Orioles, top of the ninth, bases loaded. The pitch, swing and a high fly ball. It has disappeared. I don't know if Bradley knows where it is. He doesn't know where it is. It's going back. Where is it? It went to the wall. Barfield scores. Tolleson scores. And it's 2-1 New York. Bradley had no idea where it was. Another tough break for Bob Milwaukee and the Orioles. The next night, in another tight battle, the Yanks led 2-1 in the bottom of the eighth. McCullers pitches. Swinging a roller into right field, base hit. Here comes Milligan rounding third, heading home, and he'll score without a throw. It's all tied up! Two extra innings it would go. With runners on first and second, the batter was Rene Gonzalez, who had entered the game in the top of the 10th.
2-2 game, bottom of inning number 10 here at the stadium. Gonzalez with a chance to win it. And here's the pitch. There's a line drive and a base hit to center field. That's going to drop in. Around third, here's Tettleton. He comes in to score! And the Orioles have won it!
The assortment of Orioles heroes was increasing. And when the defending American League champion Oakland A's came to town next, another star was born. Mickey Weston, a 28-year-old minor league free agent, came to spring training looking for a chance. He started the season at Rochester, then got the call. The Orioles led 3-2 in the seventh. Weston's task in his major league debut was to save Dave Schmidt's win.
The bullpen will be ready, but for now, the ball belongs to Mickey Weston, the 1-1 pitch. Little bouncer back toward the mound over Weston's head. Billy charges in from second, barehand pickup, throw to first. He got it! Two down. Memorial Stadium is coming unglued here for a moment. They're still going nuts about it. They watched it in the Diamond Vision a second time, and it looked even more incredible the second time you watched it. Two down, and here's McGuire.
Even in slow motion, it looked fantastic. That one play is worth the price of admission.
Once again, Mark McGuire stood between an Orioles rookie reliever and a dramatic save.
Top of the ninth, the rookie Mickey Weston trying to record a save in his major league debut. One out to go. The pitch, curveball, a high fly ball, shallow center. Devereaux's under it. The Orioles have taken the series 3 out of 4, and they win each of the last 3 games. After dropping the first, they lead the season series 5-3 against the American League champion Athletics, and Mickey Weston goes 3 innings of one-hit relief, retiring the last 7 men he faced to record his first Major League save, and another great day for the Orioles.
The last American League team to face the new Orioles arrived in town at the end of June. The Toronto Blue Jays had won only 12 of their first 36 games. But since then, Under new manager Cito Gaston, they were 24-14. Meanwhile, the Orioles had lost their last three. How would they fare?
The stretch. Wills delivers, the runners go. The ball is hit high and deep in the left field. This one is really hit. Bell is back, and that one is gone! A home run! A three-run homer for Randy Milligan, 12-3.
Here's Mickey Tettelin, two on, nobody out. 13-3, the Orioles in the sixth inning. The pitch. There's a long high drive deep in the right field. Felix is back. He looks up, and there she goes! A three-run homer for Tettelin, number 18, 16-3 Orioles. After winning the slugfest in Game 1, they won a pitcher's duel in Game 2. One out, nobody on. The game tied 1-2-1. Pitch to Cal. There's a high drive deep in the left center field. This one is hit very deep. Mosby back, and it's gone! A home run! Now Ripken hits one out of the ballpark. 2-1 Orioles. The Orioles' success in the first half stunned the baseball world. Who were these guys who held a 5.5-game lead at the All-Star break?
You know, fans, no pitchers have had more fun than Baltimore's outstanding crop of youngsters. Only thing is, not many know who they are. Best known is probably Greg Olson, who broke the league's rookie record with 24 saves. But he's only one pitcher. What about the starting rotation that has three rookies? Fans may not be able to name them, but rival teams in the American League certainly can, can't they?
Now that you think of it, probably not.
Let me think.
Schmidt. You got Bielicki. Well, you're getting me now.
Well, Schmidt was in the starting rotation. Ballard. We got three. Isn't that good enough?
Jeff Ballard, Pete Harnish, Bob Mielacki, and let me say,
Harnish. Is that four? Okay.
Thanks.
Sorry, Pete. Got you last.
No question. No idea. I couldn't name them all if I tried.
Mielacki, Brian Holtman. Help me out.
If opposing hitters can't name the Orioles starters, can a pitcher?
Jay Ballard, Harnish, Johnson, and Mielacki.
Nice try, but it's Jeff Ballard, not Jay.
Wow. Over the last 2 months, since May 14th, we've gone 34-19. It's been a great season. We're having a lot of fun. We're on top right now, but we're battling against the Angels this weekend. They're leading the American League West. They've won 14 out of the last 18, but I guess we're ready.
Ready they were. This one was the game of the year. The Angels scored first, then the Orioles tied it in the second. The Angels scored two in the third. The Orioles tied it with runs in the third and fourth. But then the Angels broke loose with four unanswered runs and led 7-3 after 6.5. But the sign said it all. In the last of the seventh, Steve Finley made it 7-4. And with two men on, Frank Robinson asked Joe Orsolak to pinch hit.
Now the fans are really getting into it here at the stadium as a right-hander comes to the belt. Here's the pitch. There's a shot at fair ball. This ball is heading down the right field line and heading for the corner. Worthington around to score. Finley comes in to score. The ball gets away from Armas. Orsolak is on his way to third. Here's the throw. Too late. Orsolak slides in with a triple. He drives in two runs to make it a 7-6 ball game.
Let's see that sign again. One out in the ninth. Orioles down by two. Larry Sheets was the hitter.
So now the Orioles have gotten into a situation where they can tie the game with a base hit. And Milligan with good speed at second base. Here's a pitch. There's a line drive and a base hit to right center field. Tettleton comes in to score. Here's Milligan around third. Being waved in. He scores! Tie ball game!
That brought up Mike Devereaux.
9-9 game, bottom of the ninth. If they can win this one, this might be the game of the year.
All right, now come on. Give me a good pitch to hit. Come on. All right, there it is.
pitch, and Devereaux swings and he hits a drive hit down the left field line. That ball hooking. If it's fair, it's...
Come on, stay fair. Stay fair. Stay fair. Yeah, all right.
It's gone! It's a home run! Devereaux with a home run! Bottom of the ninth inning, and the Orioles have won it! Mike Devereaux hit it directly down the left field line. He hit it high and deep. The only question, fair or foul? And it was fair by maybe a foot. Devereaux being mobbed at home plate. Over 47,000 fans on their feet. And the Orioles have come up with maybe their biggest victory of the year.
The next day featured another seesaw battle. 1-0 Angels, 2-1 Orioles, 2-2 in the ninth, and then on to the 10th and to the 11th it went. A leadoff walk to Cal Ripken brought up Mickey Tettleton.
2-2 game, bottom of the 11th inning. And the 2-2 pitch on the way. Bouncing ball, a fair ball inside the bag at first. That ball is rolling down the right field line. It is untouched. And here, around third, here comes Cal. He is being waved in. Here comes the throw. Too late! The Orioles have won it again in the bottom of the 11th inning. They have beaten California 3-2.
This was no ordinary Cinderella story. This team was the Ultra Phenomenon. A club which had lost 107 games the year before was on a rampage. They were leading the American League East with a 7.5-game cushion. As it turns out, they would need every bit of it. The Orioles took their show on the road, and for the first time all year, they went into a long, long slump. In the last game of the trip, the Orioles faced the sad prospect of losing the first-place foothold enjoyed since May 26th. That likelihood soared when the second-place Red Sox, themselves winners of 5 straight, took a commanding 6-0 lead. But this was Fenway Park, where no lead is safe, and remember, these were the unpredictable Orioles of 1989.
Tettleton hits a high drive, deep into left center field. This one has a chance, back to the wall. It is gone, a home run! And it is 6-1, Boston. Reach for and hit right over Stanley's head, up the middle, slowly. Backhanded behind second by Reed, the throw to first. Swing! And it is 6-2, Boston. The 1-1 pitch. Swing and a ground ball into the hole at short. And through into left field, a base hit. And it is 6-3. So they have cut the Boston lead right in half.
Runners on first and second with one away. Cal getting his lead at second. Tettleton is at first.
Okay, now I got him. 3-1 count. Look for something out over the plate, Randy. Get the head out. Oh, yeah, I got a good part of it. Give it out, Fritter, he's going back.
Evans backing up at the warning track, at the wall. Wave it bye-bye.
Yeah, boy.
Randy Milligan has tied it. A 3-run home run, and we're tied up at 6-6.
Take it on home.
Petzl delivers as Bradley runs, and Cal drives one into right center field, into the alleyway. Nobody's going to be able to get to it. It hits up and bounces against the bullpen wall. Bradley flies around third. He scores! A stand-up double for Cal Ripken, and the Orioles have come all the way back and have taken the lead. 7-6 Orioles.
A spectacular comeback to retain first place. The Orioles returned from their grueling road trip, ready for an August laden with home games. 17 of the next 20 games would be played before their fantastic fans, who were pouring out in record numbers. Texas came in, this time with former White Sox star and St. Michael's native Harold Baines. Two down, runner at second, no score in the game. Want to know the count? The pitch. There's a long high drive deep into center field. Back goes Devereaux. Back to the warning track, all the way back to the wall. He jumps up, he makes the catch! He slams into the wall, but he hangs on to it. A spectacular play. On the mound, once again, was Nolan Ryan. 2-0, the Orioles are out in front. Worthington hitting seventh in the order. Ryan to the plate. And that one is hit deep down the left field line. High in the air, into the corner. Is it fair or foul? It is a home run! Number 10 for Worthington. 3-0 Orioles. It was closer the next day when the Rangers led 2-1 in the bottom of the ninth. Keith Moreland, acquired from the Tigers, to aid the offense down the stretch, came to bat.
One out, Ripken at first here in the ninth inning. 2-1, Texas ahead. Here comes, swinging a drive in the right center field, going back Sierra, still going back, back to the warning track, to the wall, it's over his head! It bounces up against the wall. Cal, who had to hold, goes to third and will stop there. Two bases for Moreland, and the Orioles are really in business now. Milligan coming up. The Orioles have Cal Ripken at third base, and the pinch runner, Brady Anderson, has gone in to run at second in place of Moreland, representing the possible winning run. The pitch, curveball, looped into center field, base hit! Just over the head of the shortstop, Kunkel. Rounding third is Brady Anderson. He'll have to hold as the throw comes home. The throw now bounces away from Kruder, and going to second base is Milligan. The tying run has scored. It's 2-2. On to extra innings. In the 10th, Mike Devereaux found that down-the-line stroke again.
Here's a pitch. Devereaux swings and he sends a fly ball. Hit to left field, heading for the corner. It may be. Yes! It's in the seats! It's a home run! Devereaux has won it in the bottom of the 10th inning! It seems I've seen that before.
In a season of unlikely heroes, perhaps the most unlikely of them all emerged in August. He was a Baltimore native, an Overly High School graduate, a Middle River truck driver living in a trailer park. He was a career minor leaguer whose total major league experience consisted of a cup of coffee in Pittsburgh. To beef up a tired pitching staff in August, Roland Heeman selected this guy. There he was, Dave Johnson, on the mound, starting in front of 200 family members and friends, and he was awesome. Two men gone, and here's the leadoff hitter, Al Newman. Dave Johnson, one out away from the complete game victory. Only his second start in the big leagues. Here's the stretch and the pitch. Fly ball, left field, along the line. Bradley over to it. He's under it. And he's got it! And Dave Johnson. An overnight sensation after 7 years. Congratulated by his teammates, he goes all the way in his first ever start at Memorial Stadium. And all of a sudden, he's got nearly 28,000 friends and neighbors here. A fluke? No. 5 days later, he did it again. Everybody's standing. The Orioles with a chance to make it a 2.5 game margin again in the East. Listen to the crowd. Two strikes a count. Here's the windup. Johnson delivers.
Strike three, call. He's done it.
Dave Johnson accepting the congratulatory handshakes of his teammates. Not only are they happy for him, they're happy for themselves to have this fellow who came out of nowhere. Dave Johnson, 5 days later, comes back and does it again. The Orioles, clinging to their thin lead, were winning every which way. On a brief trip to Detroit, they won a game because of one of their brightest emerging stars. Craig Worthington, if he's an Oriole, he must be a rookie, played perhaps the best third base Orioles fans had seen since you-know-who. And his hitting was totally clutch. On this night, Jack Morris had allowed only one run through 9 innings. Two men on in the 10th.
Hit well to right field. Williams back at the fence, and he looks up at upper deck home run. 3-run home run by Worthington. 4-1 Orioles.
Get it up and let it fly. That time deep into the right field upper deck for Craig Worthington.
That was also the first bullpen committee night, when Frank Robinson used Brian Holton, Mark Thurmond, and Dave Schmidt for 3 innings apiece. They gave up just 1 run on 3 hits. Greg Olson pitched the 10th for his 18th save. Next, Bob Mellacki dominated Detroit with a 3-hit shutout. And after the Tigers salvaged the third and final game of the series, the Orioles returned home for the meat of the August pennant race.
Now we've got Toronto coming in. They're in second place and a game and a half behind. And they've won 7 of their last 10. Who's going to be today's hero?
The answer, Randy, was a fleet, gifted outfielder that the Orioles swiped from the Yankees in a Triple-A deal.
The Orioles have runners at the corners with only 2 outs. And here's Jefferson, the pitch on the way to him. There's a high fly ball, well hit left field. This one way back, and you can wave it bye-bye. Stanley Jefferson, a 3-run home run. And the Orioles are ahead 5-1.
Four more would cross the plate in an 8-run inning that propelled the Birds to an 11-6 win. That game also featured a warm reception for the Orioles' revered team leader.
And the fans are responding to Diamond Vision's message. Cal Ripken acknowledging the standing ovation as he appears in his 1,208th consecutive game, the third longest streak in Major League history.
The Jays won the next two games to pull within a half game of the Orioles, which meant they could move into first place if they could beat the Orioles August 20th. But the Orioles' defense was sharp as usual. One out and the Blue Jays with a threat. Fernandez at second, Mullinix at first. He delivers. There's a line drive into right field, a base hit. One bounce to Orsulak. Rounding third, Fernandez being waved home. Here comes the throw. Going to be close. Quirk with a tag. He got him!
And the 2-2 delivery. Drive left center field. Bradley to his left on the run. He dives and he makes a one-handed catch. What a catch by Bradley in left center field. On the run. Another fantastic defensive play by the Orioles. And Pete Harnish saying thank you, thank you, thank you.
And the offense did its job.
Now the pitch, breaking ball, swinging a high fly ball, hit directly down the left field line. This one could be, if it's a fair ball, it is! It's a two-run home run by Mike Devereaux, directly down the left field line. Sheet scores. Here comes Devereaux, and the Orioles are ahead 4-0.
And the pitching from Pete Harnish and Mark Thurmond was excellent. Once again, the Orioles fought off an unfriendly takeover bid.
Dear Mom, our whole pitching staff is doing well. Al Jackson has been great to work with, but the real secret is a great defense. It feels so good to know you can challenge a guy, and if he hits it well, your guys are going to be there. The club is the best defense I could imagine. We might set a major league record. They're running down everything.
Now it's Milwaukee. Now they're in second place. Just a half game out, and they've been incredibly hot. They've won 15 of 17. 15 of 17. We've got Ballard going tonight. No problem.
Ballard will try to come up with one more pitch. Remember, Milwaukee had runners on second and third with nobody out. Now there are two outs. And Molitor and Polidor still on the bases. Ballard bent over at the waist. He looks in. Melvin flashing signs. Ballard says yes. He sets. Here's the pitch. Breaking ball. Bouncing ball. Hit the Billy. Slowly. Billy has it. On to Milligan. Side retired. And Ballard gets it done. Pitching out of a jam. Runners on second and third with nobody out. He got three very tough hitters, and Milwaukee comes up empty.
Like I said, no problem.
Two down, ninth inning.
The Orioles ahead 5-0. The 1-0 pitch. There's a high fly ball into right center, shallow. Devereaux's under it. He waits. The Orioles win. And the Brewers, any other by far, shut down by Jeff Ballard tonight. Dave Johnson's living dream continued the next night. Two down, ninth inning. 4-2 Orioles. 2-2 to Brock. Everybody still standing. The pitch. Swinging a pop-up. Foul. Third base side. Worthington over near the seats. He's right to the tarp. He's got it. And the game is over. The Orioles have... Game three. Again, airtight defense. Here's the 2-0 pitch on the way. Swinging a bouncer past the mound towards second. Over to his right. Gonzo. He backhands it. Turns. Throws to first in time. That is an outstanding play. But the Brewers took a 1-0 lead into the bottom of the seventh. Keith Moreland was called upon to pinch hit.
So, it'll be left-hander against right-hander. Moreland in here, offensively with the bases loaded. Here's a 2-0 pitch. Line drive, a fly ball down the left field line. That ball is heading for the corner, and it is a fair ball. And it leaves the playing field. That's going to be an automatic double. As Orsilak has scored, Milligan has scored, but Sheets, who has scored, will have to go back to third. But on the double by Moreland, the Orioles have taken a 2-1 lead.
Could the Orioles sweep the Brewers, the hottest club in the league, when they arrived here 3 days earlier? Why not, we asked. An expression we would hear with increasing frequency.
The entire ballpark rising to its feet. 1-2 the count. Olsen to the plate. Reached for him, bounced to short. Cal over to backhand. It turns, throws to second. Got him! The Orioles have swept him!
As the summer months rolled by, the young Orioles of 89 adapted to life along the Chesapeake just fine, thank you.
This town is really great. The big thing here is the steamed crabs. There's nothing like them in New York. Mark Williamson calls himself an expert, and Dave Johnson should be. He's from around here. After the game the other day, they took us out and tried to show us how to eat them in the bullpen.
Show me how to eat a crab.
All right.
Will you really teach?
You gotta yank the legs off. That's big. Yank the legs off.
You have the limbs, and every now and then you'll get lucky and get some meat on there so you can taste that for a while.
Then you get little nature's little can opener, and you pull the little thing back. Cram your finger inside there, and just like, well, look at it, it broke up. And it's like you open it up.
And you pull all these little things off they call the devil. Get them out of the way. He's doing good so far.
No, he's doing okay.
Shake that out, get all the guts and the ugly stuff out of that we don't really want to eat.
And you clean it up, and you like break it in two here. You get in here, peel it open, and it's like you get all this nice meat right here. Look at that. They don't get much better than that.
And we got all the crab meat in here. Crabs are a little small right here, so there's not a lot of meat in them, but they're pretty easy to pick.
I mean, the little ones, I mean, you can mess with them and you kind of, but they're a waste.
Crab soup, too. What about the big?
How about the big claws, though? The big ones? Oh, that's great. If you pull out, it didn't work, but, you know, you got to give it one good smash.
And it works.
So that was on camera. I got it all over my eye. But we're having some fun.
The games of late August and early September were on the road. It was a trip that started well with 4 victories in 5 games in New York. In one of those games, Jeff Ballard, the ace of the staff, accomplished a remarkable feat. Hardly a strikeout pitcher, the southpaw 3 times fanned Yankee superstar Don Mattingly. Hardly a strikeout hitter.
Striking ball, and he got him. Good curveball by Ballard. And Ballard strikes him out again. And he strikes out again. Ballard had to dodge the bat, but he's tied Mattingly in knots tonight. He strikes him out for the 3rd time in the game.
In a nationally televised game the next day, Joe Orsilak, hardly a classic slugger, batted cleanup. So what did he do? Why, he hit 2 home runs, of course.
Out of here for the 2nd time.
Maybe Bob Melvin felt left out. He was the only hitter with the club all season who had not yet gone deep. So, in the series' concluding game, he delivered. And not just a homer. It was a 3-run shot to key an 8-5 win.
And it's gone!
In Cleveland, the Orioles dropped a 3-1 decision, and they led the Blue Jays again by just 1 slim game.
But it seemed the Orioles would always win the one they needed to. And a 7-run first inning the next night against Greg Swindell supported that theory. But on the last day of the month, the Blue Jays won while the Orioles lost. And the two clubs were now tied. Someone had to stop this Toronto club. They were on an extended tear with a 60-38 record under Cito Gaston. And as September began, the Jays finally wrested first place from the Orioles' grasp. Many thought the Orioles would fold once out of first place, but little did they know. The month of September would be a lesson in tenacity. The Orioles would hang right with the Blue Jays. Their style never changed, and Labor Day against the Indians featured yet another hero. The Orioles 4, Cleveland 4, last of the ninth. Tim Hewlett at the plate. 2-2 pitch. Curveball. There's a drive in the left center field. Deep. Back goes Carter. Has a chance. It's gone! They're going nuts! The Orioles have won it just like that! Tim Hewlett has won it into the Orioles' bullpen. 5-4, it's all over. 32,875. And they've all got pennant fever now. The next game was a win with perhaps the most spectacular play of the year. Cal Ripken was at bat, and Brad Kaminsk was the Cleveland center fielder. Here's Cal. He swings and drives one deep in the left center field. This one is really hit. It has a chance, and this one is caught by Kaminsk. He flipped up over the wall, and he fell over the wall. He has disappeared from sight. Joe Carter runs out there as Cal runs the bases. And it is going to be a home run! A home run! Kaminsk just now climbing back over the wall. A home run for Cal Ripken, number 20. What an extraordinary play! At the 387-foot sign, Kaminsk went to the wall. He put his hand on the top of the wall and then leaped up over the wall, bending over the wall as he reached out to catch it, and he lost his balance and catapulted right over. Out of play with the baseball in his glove, and that was the last we saw of him. Joe Carter could only say, wow. That home run made Cal the first shortstop ever to hit 20 home runs or more in 8 straight seasons. Cleveland took the third game of the series, but even in defeat, Orioles fans enjoyed a special moment. Ben McDonald, regarded as the most talented amateur player in all of America, had been selected first in the nation by the Orioles. Now, 3 months later, he would make his Major League debut. The fans, beholding an historic moment, were clearly excited.
And as Ben McDonald makes his way in, the crowd begins to roar. The nation's number one draft choice. He'll come in with a count of 1-2. The Indians with runners on first and third and only one away in a 4-0 lead.
And he didn't disappoint them.
Again, Carter bluffing. Here's a 1-2 delivery. Bouncing ball hit to Cal. Cal to second for one, and here's the relay. A double play. Ben McDonald, in his Major League debut, throws one pitch and gets a double play ball to retire the side.
Exciting as McDonald's debut was, the Orioles found themselves 2 games behind the Blue Jays as they headed to Texas for a 5-game, 4-day series. The Ryan Express, even in the Texas twilight, could not stop the Orioles.
Whoa, to right field to the corner. Sierra will have to hurry to keep Ripken from scoring. And now Ripken being waved. They got a shot. And the relay to the plate is not going to be in time. 1-0. And on to third. Play at the plate goes Larry Sheet to the Birds, lead 1-0.
And when the Birds swept a doubleheader that day, they were a half game closer to first place. And off in the distance, a season-ending series in Toronto was looking increasingly significant.
Dear Flanny, this thing looks like it might go down to the wire. When you guys win, we win. When you lose, we lose. Every day it seems like we're 1 game back.
In the 28 days that preceded the Toronto weekend, the two clubs did the same thing in 17 of those days. In fact, only twice in that period did the Blue Jays lose on the same day that the Orioles won. It appeared that one of those nights would be September 19th. The Orioles, 2 games out, hosted the Tigers. 2 down, runner at first, the left-handed hitting quirk coming up. Morris at the belt, the 1-strike delivery,
Swing and a drive in the right center field. Lucado on the run to his right. He's not going to be able to get to it. The ball will roll to the fence. Worthington around second on his way to third. He's rounding third, being waved home. The ball relayed to Whitaker. Whitaker's going to throw to third instead. Scoring is Worthington. Back to second is Quirk safely. 1-0 Orioles. Man in scoring position. 1-0 Orioles. Two down. Hewlett, another veteran, hitting .233. Two home runs. Nine batted in. 3-2. The pitch. Swing, ground ball, left field, base hit. Rounding third is Quirk, charging the ball in left and picking it up and throwing it to second is Richie. Quirk scores, 2-0 Orioles. And as the game ended, the crowd erupted with the news that Boston had gone ahead of Toronto in the 10th inning at the Sky Dome. But the Jays came back in the 10th to tie. Players watched in the clubhouse as the Red Sox went ahead again in the 11th. But it was not to be. The Blue Jays came back again and won in their half of the 11th. A win for the Orioles, but they could gain no ground. Some say that one of the greatest beauties of baseball is that you come right back the next day. Pain lasts only until you're ready to go again. And the sting of the Blue Jays' win healed on an exciting September 20th. Jeff Ballard, 7-1 in his last nine starts, and the winningest left-hander in the league, was in control. Meanwhile, Randy Milligan and Mickey Tettleton keyed the offense. Then, during a break in the middle of the eighth, the crowd received good news.
Why not? Why not? Why not? Can you believe where we are today?
An Orioles win. A Toronto loss, and the lead was reduced to one game. The Yankees, in town for the last weekend of the year at home, nipped the Birds in the opener, back to two games out. But behind Bob Benacki the next night, the Orioles gained ground again. Hewlett is batting .282. Bases loaded, we're ready to go. The pitch on the way. Fastball lined into center field, that's a base hit. Coming in to score is Milligan. Rounding third is Jefferson. He'll score. Going to third is Quirk. The throw into second. A two-run single for Hewlett. 2-0 Orioles. Hewlett had 15 RBIs in 26 games. And in his best Pat Tabler act, was 5-for-5 with the bases loaded after joining the ball club August 23rd. Stan Jefferson's scrappy play resulted in another run.
Now here's Steve Finley with runners on first and third, only one away. Yankees are looking for a double play ball. Here's a pitch. He's swinging a little bouncing ball to Ben Mattingly. There's a play at the plate, and it is too late. Now Jefferson missed the plate, and he's safe again as they missed a tag.
The Birds were 16-3 in the last 19 starts made by Jeff Ballard and Bob Malacky combined. The last scheduled home game of the year was Sunday, September 24th. It was a home season that could only be understood by those who experienced it, and they were many. In a gesture of gratitude to these amazing fans, the Orioles gave them the shirts off their backs after that game. The game itself, a loss, coupled with a Toronto loss, meant the Orioles were still one game back with a week to go. And only three games until a potential showdown in Toronto.
Well, Flanny, I guess we're headed for a showdown. And just remember, the pressure's all on you guys. Your club was the one picked to win this thing, not us. We were barely picked to come in seventh. And if it comes down to the weekend, it'll be just like the Brewer Series of 1982. And we both remember how exciting that was.
In Milwaukee, the Orioles won on Monday night. The Blue Jays won also. This ensured that the race could not be decided before the weekend in Toronto. Both clubs lost Tuesday, and both won Wednesday. Mickey Tettleton provided the game-winning blast, providing the Orioles with their margin of victory. And so, here it was. The Orioles trailed by one, with three to play. The championship of the season to be determined in one final head-to-head series. The weekend in Toronto. It was a major event. Fans from Birdland flocked to Canada. The media descended upon the beautiful 21st century Sky Dome.
It's been a weekend that gives a lot of meaning to this advertising slogan. These are exciting times. These are extraordinarily exciting times.
A win in the first game would tie the Orioles for first place. A loss meant they'd have to win the next two to end up in a tie. If there was a tie, it would be played back in Baltimore on Monday afternoon. The game was about to begin. Phil Bradley, whose stated goal in life at the start of the season was simply to play for a winning team, was now playing for higher stakes, and he was ready.
The first pitch of the night from Toronto, Todd Stottlemyre. Bradley, it's gone to left field. Tell it goodbye. 1-0 Orioles. The Orioles are in Toronto and have immediately made their presence felt. Phil Bradley on the first pitch of the game. Talk about breaking the ice.
An exciting start for the Orioles, who had 18-game winner Jeff Ballard on the mound. And he was brilliant.
Ballard on top. Here comes. Swing and a miss. He struck him out with a breaking ball on the outside. Nice pitch.
The Orioles' defense was also in fine form.
There goes Fernandez. The pitch. Swing and a miss. Now to throw to second, and they may get Borders. They do! What was he doing? Here's a set again by Ballard. And they've got him picked off at first base. Here's Milligan's throw to second is in time. 1-3-6. So the Blue Jays have another runner thrown out on the bases. There's a ground ball up the middle. Cal diving stop behind second. He throws. He got him! What a play by Cal Ripken. An amazing play by Cal.
Inning after inning, 1-0 it remained. In the eighth, Ballard gave way after another outstanding clutch performance. And the lad who relieved was the only man for the job. But without Greg Olson and his breathtaking curveball and blazing fastball, these games wouldn't have mattered in the first place. On this night, though, with a runner on third, one of his curveballs would betray him. Wild pitch, a tie game. In a testament to grace under pressure expected only from the most seasoned veterans, the rookie, a mere 22 years of age, was unshaken. Olson would protect the tie through the ninth, and he continued into the 10th, his third and final inning of work. The Jays mounted a huge threat. The winning run was on third with only one out, but Olson refused to wilt. He retired the rookie John Olerud and the veteran Gruber once again to prevent the Jays from ending the game. Finally, in the 11th, the Blue Jays got the big hit from veteran Lloyd Mosby. And an emotionally exhausting first game of the series belonged to Toronto. The Orioles, behind rookie Pete Harnish, would have to win tomorrow. Fate plays unusual games, and late on Friday night, it dictated a change in the starting rotation. Walking back to the team hotel after the game, Harnish accidentally stepped on a nail. The injury would prevent him from making the start. Where's that kid from Middle River? Dave Johnson, this starts for you. Yes, Dave Johnson would be asked to pitch the game of his life on national TV to keep his club alive. And the game of his life, he did pitch. And of course, as any Orioles pitcher of 89 would, Johnson relied on brilliant defense.
The 1-2 pitch now to Kelly Gruber. Spank to center.
Boy, he has used this spacious center field very, very wisely, hasn't he? And used Devereaux. What a performance.
The offense pecked away.
3-2 pitch, line over Gruber's head. Fair ball down the line. Now let's see if Bradley can score.
There it is.
The ball was touched by a fan.
He sent it back. Trent Robinson's going to come out and argue. They are going to score the runner.
This will be a 1-2 pitch. He waits on it and lines it into left for a hit. Charging and unloading. Well, is in there. The throw comes through, so Milligan moves to second, and the Orioles have the lead.
And through seven gritty innings, Johnson and the Orioles led the Jays 3-1. When Johnson walked the leadoff hitter in the eighth, the tying run came to bat. It was time to let the bullpen try to preserve Dave's effort. But the Jays were determined in the eighth. They needed three runs to go ahead. Two walks, a sacrifice, a couple of singles, and a sacrifice fly later, they led 4-3. A 1-2-3 Orioles ninth, and the pennant race was over. The miracle had ended. Disappointing? Of course. Devastating? Hardly. The weekend was full of clean, terrific baseball, handled with class by both organizations.
The fans in Toronto, made up of Blue Jays and Orioles fans alike, were a model of enthusiasm, good sportsmanship, and courtesy.
Oh, it's been fantastic for the Orioles.
Well, we're having a great time. I like it up here, and the Canadians are fantastic.
And on Sunday, we were reminded of the bright future, albeit in an anticlimactic game, as Ben McDonald earned his first Major League win. The Orioles hung not their heads in shame. Instead, their chins were high, their hearts bursting with pride. Awaiting their arrival were thousands of the heartiest fans sports has known. The nasty rain made their perseverance all the more admirable. The depth of their love all the more astonishing. A parade on Monday was the last element of the season.
It's gonna get a little wet today.
Here comes the rain! Here comes the rain, doo-doo-doo-doo. Here comes the rain, and I say, it's all right.
The fans ignored the rain. They had much more important things in their minds. Their heroes were bidding farewell to the 1989 season, a season their fans would never forget. And they, as much a part of it as the players themselves, had to be there.
We got them in the overhangs. We got them on the street curb, swaying the Oriole paraphernalia.
I want to ask you to remember last spring when every expert in baseball said the Orioles would finish seventh. One said the Orioles would finish seventh because there was no place lower to finish. I ask you to remember that. Well, we all know what team spent 116 days in first place this year. We all know what team spent 98 consecutive days in first place. We went from worst to almost first, and that's something we're pretty proud of.
You know, we see all the signs here, and we saw them all year long that you loved us. But we just want to let you know, we love you too. Thank you.
Like I said, what a season. A year like this convinces you that we're on the right track with our rebuilding effort. And we shouldn't fool ourselves. We've still got a ways to go. But with the hustle and vitality we showed this year, it seems like we'll have a lot of fun getting there. You know, the fans call us their heroes. But with the way they help us, we know who the real heroes are.
Yeah.
Thank you.